Good morning, friends. We're so glad to see your smiling faces here and look forward to being able to see your smiling faces for those of you that are still at home. Know that we love you and miss you. And we're so blessed to be able to come and freely worship our Savior. And so just worship with us.
Humble, humble.
flesh and fire of life you are. Not too proud to wear our skin, to know this weary world we're in. Humble, humble Jesus.
Dear Heavenly Father, we are here to lift you high this morning. We are here to exalt you. Lord, we pray that you're exalted in our singing as we sing of our experience of you and our knowledge of you. And we pray that you'd be exalted in the preaching and the hearing of your word. And that all that is said will be about you and will be to point to you and to glorify you and to make you known better, that we could see you more clearly and know you more deeply. Lord, please be with us and strengthen us this morning. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, good morning, good morning. It's a hot one today, isn't it? That makes you thankful for air conditioning. It's one of those things you don't really realize you have until you don't have it. Living in Dominican for 3 years without air conditioning, you do learn to appreciate it. This was a normal day for us for about probably six, seven months of the year. So God has blessed us. We are comfortable in here, and we are here to listen to the preaching of God's word this morning. If you would turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Revelation. But don't get too excited. We're not going to be talking about seals and beasts and trumpets this morning. We're going to be there in the first chapter today. I do want to ask you, though, this morning, how many of you either thought or mentioned to a family member that you were going to go to church, or it was time to go to church, or let's get ready to go to church? I'm sure all of us, that was in our mind or on our lips at some point this morning. And when we said that, were we thinking that there's a place we're going to, or is it a people we're going to gather with? Because often when we use the word church, what do we mean? We mean a place, a building. We go to the church. We talk about, you know, when you're figuring out your church budget, you have church maintenance. Well, you're not talking about the people, you're talking about the building, right? When we, you know, they talk in the news, maybe a church burns down. We're talking about the church building. We often are talking about a building when we use the word church. But interestingly enough, the Bible never refers to the building, a building, when it's talking about a church. The word for church is used 114 times in the New Testament, and it's always referring to assembly, a gathering of people. And the Greek word for church actually means called out ones. And so we are those who are called out from the world to gather together. I like how the Puritans, they did not call the building the church or the church building. They referred to it as the meeting house, to make the distinction that that's a building and we are the church. But as you may know, the book of Revelation is a letter written to the churches. We don't think about Revelation as a letter, but it is. I mean, it is prophecy, but it's written or presented in the form of a letter. John writes a letter. He addresses it as a letter at the beginning. And then there's like seven cover letters this book was to be sent to seven different churches that are in current present-day Turkey. And these churches, though, represented all churches. And so this is the revelation to the churches. And so to understand a church is important to understand, or to understand what a church is important to understand Revelation, because the word church appears many, many times throughout Revelation. But even as us, as a church, we need to know what it is to be a church. What does it mean to be a gathering of believers? And in looking at Revelation, we're going to look at the first seven verses. So you see that we got there's a book written to seven churches. We're going to look at the first seven verses, and we're going to find seven different descriptions of the church. And we're going to ask the Lord to help us to understand better what is the church, and also that we can examine ourselves to see if we are being what God has called us to be. So let's take a look at Revelation chapter 1, and let's read verses 1 through 7. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show to his servants the things that must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to the servant John, his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keep what is written in it, for the time is near. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from his sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. So here is John's introduction. And again, what we see here, we're going to mine these passages to find these seven different descriptions or words that talk about what the church is. Now, this isn't an exhaustive list. We could go and we can add a lot more. But we are going to see what this passage has to say. And these would apply to the church in general, but many of these also apply, broadly to us as a people. But most of these also apply to us as individuals as well. And so the first one we see here is that we, the church, are Christ's servants. Christ's servants. That's how he addresses them in verse 1. He says, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants. He's talking about the church, the people to whom he is writing. Now, this word servants, the Greek word here is doulos, or the plural, douloi. And this is a word that that we often see in the New Testament. Jesus often talks about servants or slaves in his parables, and these refer to believers often. They're representing the people, characters in his parables that are the servants are representing believers. Also, we see that the apostles in their letters often refer to themselves in their introduction, in the salutation, as a servant of Christ or a servant of the Lord. Paul does this three times. Also does so does James, Peter, Jude, and then John here in Revelation refers to himself as a servant in the same verse. He says he made it known by sending his angel to his servant, John. So it's a very common word to refer to believers. Now, doulos, this word doulos, can be translated both slave and servant. So, of course, we like to translate it to servant when we're talking about us, right? Why is it? So it depends on the context, which way you would translate it. Sometimes it's also bond servant. So doulos, what it really means, the essence of this word is someone who is completely and unconditionally subject to his master. Someone who is completely and unconditionally subject to his master. Now, this can be done voluntary, which would be a servant, or involuntary, which would be a slave. But the main idea here is that this is someone who belongs to someone else, that they report everything to someone else. As one dictionary put it, the doulos belongs by nature not to himself, but to someone else. This is the essence of a doulos. And this is something that, a concept we're not very familiar with, we're not used to in our society. We don't really have this category anymore in thinking about the structure of our society. In our society, we don't have servants, we don't have slaves, we have freelancers, and we have employees, right? Okay, so you can be a freelancer. What does that mean? That you don't necessarily work for somebody. You're not employed by somebody. But that you get to go and pick what jobs you want to do. And you get to negotiate a contract with someone. And your only obligation is to that contract. And if there's a certain job that you don't want to do, you don't have to try to get that job. You don't have to have a contract for that job. You just picked which ones you want to do, and you determine what you want to do, what your obligations are going to be, and then when you're done with that job, then your obligations are done. So that's freelancers. These are contractors. You know, they decide they negotiate with the person who is paying them, who is hiring them for that job. We also have employees. Employees, they don't have quite as many rights and freedoms as a freelancer. Now, their time does belong to the employer as long as they're in their time frame, you know, their hours of the job. And they have to do whatever the employer tells them to do. You know, they're not there to negotiate with the employer or give him suggestions or tell him what they think is the better way to do things unless the employer wants them to do that. But even employees, you know, they still have rights, especially in our country. I mean, the employer just can't treat their employees however they want to. There's only so many hours in a day that they can work or in a week that they can work, and they have to be paid a certain amount of money. And you know, in some places, you can collectively bargain with other employees in a union, and you can have a lot of rights that the employer has to respect. So we have these freelancers, we have employees, but we don't have a doulos. A doulos has no rights. A doulos can make no demands on his master. He just has to do whatever he is told. And Christ calls douloi. He does not call employees to follow him. He doesn't call freelancers. That's not what he wants. He wants a doulos. Luke 9:23, Jesus said, "If any man would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me." See, that is leaving yourself behind. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, when Christ calls a man, he bids him to come and die. You die to your rights. You leave those behind. You don't come with demands of Jesus. You come ready and willing to obey and follow. Romans 10:9 says, "If we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe with our hearts that God raised him from the dead, we'll be saved." If we confess him with our mouth, what? That he is Lord, that he is master, not our boss. Our master. He's in complete control. Now, there's some that want to make a distinction here in our salvation. They say, well, you know, I received Christ as my Savior, but it wasn't until later that I received him or made him, even worse, I think, say, make God your Savior, make Jesus your Savior, make him your Lord. But we receive him, we recognize him as such. They say, you know, I made Jesus my Savior, and then later on, I made him my Lord. Well, no, it's, don't you see this verse? It says, whoever confesses with his mouth that Jesus is Lord is saved. So it's not like a two-part deal. It's a complete package. You cannot become a Christian until you are ready to submit to the Lordship of Christ. That's part of it. Now, that does not mean that we are perfectly submissive, and it is a dynamic process where we're growing in our submission, we're repenting, and we're submitting ourselves every day. But recognize that when Jesus is calling for followers, he's calling for disciples, he is calling for people who will be his servants, who will follow him, who will be his douloi. And so that's what we are as a church. We are Christ's servants. So what is your posture towards Christ? Do you approach him as a freelancer? You're here to negotiate with him and say, okay, here are the four or five things I'm willing to do for you, but I don't want to do the rest of these things. You have to get someone else to do that. Or are you coming as an employee and you're saying, okay, well, Lord, I'll give you some of my time so you can have these particular hours of the week and I'll serve you then. But then I got my free time, I got my time off, and that's when I get to do what I want to do. Or are you coming as a doulos? Are you coming submitting to him? Are you coming willing to say, whatever it is you are calling and you want me to do, I am here to do it. I am your servant. Just tell me what to do. That's what Jesus is calling us for. We are the church. We are Christ's servants. And as his servants, what does he call us to do? One of the things he calls us to do is to be his witnesses. We see that here in verse 2. He says, picking up at the end of verse 1, he made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. So John, being the servant, being the doulos, he was also a witness. Or you may also say, your translation may say that he gave testimony, or he testified. But it can be translated either way. A witness is someone who testifies. He's a testifier. He bears witness or gives testimony. And so so we are called to be his witnesses. Now, when we use this word often in the church and in Christian circles, we often use it to mean either evangelism, sharing the gospel with someone, or our lifestyle and how our lifestyle affects the way people see or respond to the gospel. For example, you know, we say, well, I witnessed to my neighbor, meaning, you know, I shared the gospel with my neighbor. Or we may say, you know, lying is bad for your Christian witness, meaning that, you know, if you are lying, then that is going to look disfavorably towards the gospel message that you are proclaiming and give people the bad impression of what a Christian is and who Jesus is. Now, those are okay, but we want to get to the root of what does it mean in the Bible to be a witness? What does that word mean? And you can have the verb witness, or you can have a noun to be a witness, you know, the person that's a witness. And it can be a thing, too. It's the testimony that we give. And so it's a testimony. It's the person who testifies to what he has seen and heard. We spoke about this. We talked about this, I think, one of the first times that I came here. I think it was back last fall. We talked about what it was to be a witness. And remember, it's someone who testifies, who bears witness to what he has seen and heard. So we really want to think about it. It's like what a person in the courtroom who is called, the witness, they're called to testify to what they've seen and heard. You know, they have testimony to give that is pertinent to the case at hand. It is going to be evidence for or against the person that is on trial. Or you may think of a reporter who is gathering facts for his story. And they're looking for witnesses, people that have firsthand knowledge of what has happened. You know, this is what it means here in its essence when the Bible talks about being a witness, that we testify to what we have seen and heard. Notice that's what John says, that he bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. So he's bearing witness to what is revealed to him. That's what he records here in the rest of this book. And so we see here very clearly that John, anyway, was a witness. Now, but I'm trying to apply this to all of us. Now, how do we know that we are all supposed to be witnesses? This just says John is a witness. Well, remember we talked about Acts 1:8? You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the world. And back when we looked at that verse, we saw how the book of Acts shows that that verse was not just about the apostles, but this applies to all believers. And we don't have time to get into that this morning. But the Bible, if you study the word witness, it is talking about all of us. As a church, we are Christ's witnesses. So we are to give testimony to what we have seen and heard, okay? We are not just reporters. Reporters have to get the facts from someone else and then report it. No, we are actually speaking of our experience. So we testify to what we have heard. We've testified to what we have seen. We have seen this is our subjective experience, how we've experienced the gospel in our lives. If you're a Christian, you have experienced the Holy Spirit. You have experienced Christ. You know what it means to have a relationship with God. And so when you testify, when you bear witness, you're able to speak from this experience that you have. But we also testify to the objective truth of the gospel. And so we have the witness of the apostles recorded here. And so this is the basis of our subjective experience. In other words, anybody can come and claim to have an experience. There's people in other religions that complain that claim to have an experience. We come and we say, this is the objective truth. And I have seen this to be true in my life. I have experienced this in my life. So we testify to both the objective message, the truth, and our experience of this truth. Both are important because people are saved by hearing the objective message. They need to hear the gospel that Jesus is the Son of God, that Jesus lived a perfect life, that Jesus died on the cross, a criminal's death in our place, that he received God's punishment for our sins, that he rose again in 3 days, and that he offers salvation to all who repent and turn away from their sins and turn to him in faith, entrusting him to have a right relationship with God. This is the message that we must testify to. But then when we testify to our experience, This gives validity to our message. We're saying this is not just something I've heard about. I know this is true because I have seen how God has worked in my heart. I've seen how he's worked in other people's lives. I've seen people who you would not believe how they were. They were the worst of the worst, and I've seen them totally transformed into a new person. This is our testimony. And why does this matter? Why do we need to be faithful witnesses? Well, faithful witnesses to the truth are the ones who win the victory over Satan. As we are faithful to our testimony, this is how we have victory. You remember in the movie Wizard of Oz, when Dorothy and her friends first approached the wizard, they had that big manifestation and the big huge head and all the smoke and the lights and the noise, and they're terrified. And then the second time they come, remember, Toto goes and pulls back the curtain. And we see that all this other stuff's just an illusion. And reality is this man behind the curtain just pulling the levers. And this is how Satan is. Satan is the master of deceit. He's the father of lies. In the book of Revelation, there seems like there's a reality. It seems like Satan's winning. It seems like he's in control. It seems like the church is on the retreat. It seems like the church is defeated. And we look around us, it seems that way in our world today. It seems like Satan's winning. But what the book of Revelation does is pull back the curtain. What we see is a spiritual reality behind that. We see that what appears to be is not so. And that Christ already has the victory. He won the victory on the cross. And Satan's defeat is inevitable. And so we're called to remain faithful to our witness. And we see Revelation chapter 12, verse 11 says, "And they," talking about the believers, "have conquered him," Satan, "by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. For they loved not their lives even to death." So in other words, they stayed true to their testimony. They did not surrender it. They did not recant their faith when things got difficult for them. But it was the blood of Jesus who conquered Satan, and they stayed true in trusting in that blood and testifying to that blood. And that is how Satan is overcome. We don't have to come at him with swords and weapons. We come at him with just being faithful to the testimony of Jesus Christ, sharing that testimony to the world, exposing the lies for what they are. Now, faithful witnesses also win people to the kingdom. Another way Satan is defeated, way do we see the kingdom growing, the way we see the church growing, is when we are faithful to testify to others of who Jesus is and our experience of him. And, you know, church growth, if you really think about it, is not that hard. How do you grow the church? Well, if each person is sharing their faith and can just win one person in the next year, what happens? Your church doubles, right? So we just have to be faithful to being Christ witnesses. So are you being a faithful witness? Are you sharing your faith? Are you holding fast to the truth when the world around you is believing the lies? See, that's the thing is everybody else still is looking at the distraction. You know, thinking back of Wizard of Oz again, we're looking at the man, and they don't know what's behind the curtain. But we're out there, we're to switch metaphors, we are declaring that the emperor has no clothes. The problem is everybody else thinks that the emperor does have clothes, but we know the truth. And by the grace of God, by the Holy Spirit, he's going to show other people that what we're proclaiming is also true, and they're going to see the truth. And they'll be able to reject Satan's lies and belong to God. So we are a church of servants. We are a church of servants who are witnesses, who are testifying to the truth of the gospel. And as testifying servants, we are also called to be obedient servants. Obedient servants. That's what we see next. So looking at verse 3, "Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keep what is written in it, for the time is near." Blessed, he says, are those who hear and then obey or keep what is written in it. Okay, we know the verse James 1:22. He says, be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving ourselves. So we are deceiving ourselves if we think in just hearing and knowing the word is sufficient. But no, what really matters is that we are obeying. Solomon knew a lot. Solomon, King Solomon, had a lot of knowledge. He was the wisest man to ever walk the earth. And yet, all his knowledge did not translate into obedience, did it? And so we want to be not just hearers, but doers. Jesus said in John 14:5, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. See, this is one of the tests of true followers. A true church is a church that loves Jesus and demonstrates that love by obedience. Now notice that love is not the same as obedience, but love or obedience demonstrates or is evidence of our love for our Savior. And so it's interesting, though, if we look in this particular context as we think about obedience, we look at what John is saying. He says specifically to obey what? Obey this prophecy. Now think about that for a minute. You don't normally think of prophecy as something to obey. You obey commandments. How do you obey prophecy? Let's think about that. What this prophecy says here in Revelation is that God is in control, that Jesus is coming back to establish his kingdom. Satan is already defeated. There will be a new heaven and a new earth. And so if all these things are true, then that's going to affect how we live. So to obey the prophecy is to believe that these things are true and then adjust our lives accordingly. I mean, if all these things are true, how then does that affect how we invest our money? I mean, if houses and cars and boats and vacation homes and designer clothes and all these things are going to pass away, as Revelation tells us they are, then how are we going to invest our money? Or how are we going to invest our time? I mean, is sports and Netflix and Fox News and all these other things we can spend our time on, if all those things are going to pass away, then how are we going to invest our money? If in fact we have an inheritance waiting for us in this new heaven and this new earth, how then are we going to fight temptation to settle for lesser things? If in fact God is going to make all things new, how then can we fight despair and depression? You see, we are obeying this prophecy. We are living as if these things are true. And if these things are true, you can't keep on living the way that you used to live. So obeying prophecy means living according to eternal realities. And that's what the church is. A church is marked by those who are looking to the future and not living in the moment as if this is all that there is. So we are his servants who testify to his gospel as we obey his truth. Fourthly, we the church also are those who are loved by Christ. We are loved by Christ. If we read on verse 4, John to the seven churches that are in Asia, Christ, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and to the ruler of the kings of earth. Here it is. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood. It's he who loves us. The Bible in Revelation, we see it in Revelation 19. We see it in other places that we, the church, are Christ's bride. That's a really powerful image. And that's not saying every individual person is a bride of Christ. That gets a little awkward. But we, the church, as his people, are Christ's bride. That just makes me think, especially I read Revelation chapter 19, and we have this vision of the marriage feast of the Lamb, and where the bridegroom Christ is finally united with his spotless bride, the church. And I can't help but think of my own wedding day. I can't help but thinking, we were in this church and it didn't have a center aisle. You just had the two kind of outs, or sort of, you know, you had the center section and the aisles on either side. And so everybody stood up, you know, when the bride is coming in. And so I'm up front. I couldn't see anything until she was about 2/3 of the way down, and I'm dying to see. And then finally, all of a sudden, there she was. Beautiful, radiant bride. Our anniversary is this Friday, by the way. So, and there she was, and I'm tears are coming to my eyes. Just thinking about how much I loved her. Now, 16 years later, how much more I love her. And this is what Jesus says, that we are his bride, the church, that he treasures us, that he loves us. And what does it say in Ephesians chapter 5? It says that he is making us spotless, taking away every wrinkle, every stain, so that when we get to Revelation chapter 9, we will be his pure bride that he loves. And he loves us even now. He loves us to the extent that while we were yet sinners, Romans 5:8 says, Christ died for us. He didn't wait for us to get cleaned up. He died for us. You remember the book of Hosea, where God calls Hosea to go and marry a prostitute. Someone that was not worthy of him. He goes, he gets his prostitute, he brings her to himself, cleans her up, provides everything that she needs. Then she goes off and back to her suitors, and then he has to go and get her and bring her back again. Jesus is not going to give up on us until we are his spotless, pure bride. So we are loved, we are greatly loved. So how does that impact us? Well, let us love then, as we have been loved by Christ. Jesus said in John 13:34, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. Even more specifically, we want to drill down to Ephesians chapter 5:25, very specific application for us husbands. Husbands, love your wives. How? As Christ loved the church. So those who have been loved are those who love. Right? So we are loved by Christ. We are Christ's servants. We are his witnesses. We are also subjects in his kingdom. Take a look at verse 6. And made us, Christ made us a kingdom. Made us a kingdom. Now, when we think about a kingdom, what do you normally think of? You think of maybe a country, a location, you know, the realm where the king lives and where he exercises his reign. So you think of it that way, you say, well, where then is Christ's kingdom? I mean, where's his territory, so to speak? Well, when we look in the New Testament, it's talking about the reign of Christ. It's not talking about a territory, per se. It's just talking about where Christ's authority is acknowledged. So it is where his reign is acknowledged. So, in other words, Christ's kingdom exists wherever the church exists. So he's not reigning. You know, you look at the Old Testament kings, like King David, you know, they reigned over the nation of Israel, this particular piece of land in the ancient Near East. But you look at Christ's kingdom, it's not confined to a particular piece of land in the ancient or in the Middle East. But it is all throughout the world, wherever the church is, in all nations, there you will find the church worshiping. And one day, Jesus is coming back, and he's going to territorially reign over all of this as well, so that he will have a territory to rule over and a people to rule over. But now, wherever we see Christ acknowledged, worshipped, and obeyed, that is where he is reigning and where he is ruling. And so we, as his subjects, work to extend his kingdom. We work to extend his kingdom, his rule, over our own lives. Remember, going back to our first point, that we are his servants. So we are forever submitting ourselves more and more to Christ's reign. We are also looking to extend his rule throughout the church, that the church would become more and more obedient to the Lord, and we'll be drawing more and more into his kingdom. And so as we are loving one another, as we just talked about, we are then also extending his reign in the church. Then we also looking to our community and throughout the world as we are testifying, we are bearing witness to the gospel and bringing more people into his kingdom and growing the church. So this is our job, is to, as subjects of the king, is to extend his kingdom in ourselves, in our church, and in our world. Okay, so that's number 5. Got 2 more to go. We're just going to go quickly through those as we're running out of time. The next one we see here is that we are a kingdom of what? A kingdom of priests. Kingdom of priests. continuing that verse 6, and that Christ made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. So we are a kingdom of priests. What do priests do? They minister before the king. The functions of the priest in the Old Testament, three primary ones. One, that they were a mediator between God and people. That's normally what we think of. They're the ones that are able to enter into the temple or into the tabernacle. Not every Israelite could do that. Only the priest could do that on behalf of the people. They were the ones who offered the sacrifices on behalf of the people. This was to demonstrate to the people that God was was holy. They were not. And so there had to be someone to go between God and the people. That was the priest. Also, another function is that they were supposed to be teachers of the law. That was commanded of them in Leviticus, that they were supposed to teach the law to the people so that they would know what God expected of them. Also, the priests were discerners of God's will. You remember the high priest, he had the fancy ephod and the garments that he would wear when he's doing his duties, and he would carry on those two little what we think are for probably like lots or dice called the Urim and the Thummim. The Urim and the Thummim. I think that's the first time I've actually pronounced those out loud before. And these were just a ways when there was a big ponderous decision, the people needed direction from God, they would consult the Urim and the Thummim. And so presumably the priest would have to cast these lots and then that would give them God's direction. By the way, this is just an aside. You notice that the last time we see anyone casting lots for to discern God's will is in Acts chapter 1, right before Pentecost, to choose the successor of Judas. After that, you never see it happen anymore. Why is that? I think it's because now we have the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. We don't use those types of methods anymore. We have the Spirit and the Word of God to guide us. But anyway, so that's what the priests would do. They would help to discern God's will. So this is different, though, a little bit for us because we don't have to go through priests anymore. Jesus is our high priest. And because we have Jesus as our high priest, we don't need this mediator. Only Jesus is our mediator. But the Bible tells us that we are a priesthood. We are a priesthood of believers. And as a doctrine, a priesthood of believers. Well, that doesn't mean that we, as each individual Christians, have the right to interpret the Bible however we want to. It doesn't mean we get to apply the Bible however we want to. But what it means is that all believers have direct access to God and all believers serve as priests. Now, what does that mean? We have to qualify that. We have to explain that. What does it mean that we serve as priests? We're not offering sacrifices. We're not carrying Urim and Thummim around. But we still mediate between God and man. We mediate the gospel to the lost, don't we? So here is God who has a message of salvation. Here are lost people that need to be saved. Who does he send? He sends us. We're the mediators. We go in between to bring people to God. So in this sense, we serve as mediators. We also teach God's word. We're supposed to make disciples, just like the Old Testament prophets did, or priests did. We're supposed to be making disciples, teaching God's word. It's not just for pastors and preachers to teach. We're all called to be disciple makers. And also, we discern God's will. As I said, we have the Holy Spirit, do we not? And so, as priests to God, we serve in these ways, okay? So we're the church, we're a church of priests, each one of us. Direct access to God through Jesus. But then, in a secondary function, we also serve as a kind of priest to God. And then lastly, we are hopeful as a church. We are hopeful as we are serving him, as we are testifying, as we are loving, as we are serving and doing our priestly duties. We are also doing all this with hope in the Lord's return. Look at verse 7. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him. Even those who pierced him and all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. So we are hopeful because the Lord is coming back. And this is not a hope in the sense of wishful thinking. Like, you know, I hope it rains tomorrow. I hope it doesn't rain tomorrow. I don't know. It might not. I hope it's not 120 degrees again tomorrow. Probably will be. No, this is a sure hope. This is a confident hope because God has promised it. Jesus has promised it. And if he said he's going to do it, he's going to do it. God always keeps his promises. And so therefore, this is a hope that you can bank everything on. But not all are looking forward to this. Look what it says. When he comes, it says all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. This is not a good thing. Wailing. There will be an anguish when Christ returns because they are not ready for his return. Remember when you're a kid and you and your brothers and sisters are at home alone and then maybe your mom calls to say that she's on her way home? How did you respond to that? Was that all of a sudden dread, panic, and terror? Mom is on the way home. Oh no, we got to clean up the house. Got to untie my brother. Got to get everything ready. And you know, only got 10 minutes. You know, or was it a good thing? Hey, mom's coming home. She went to the store and she's got ice cream for us. You know, it's kind of like that. It depends on your perspective whether it's good news if mom's coming home. So are you looking forward to Jesus' return? Are you ready for Jesus' return? Well, have you submitted to him to be his servant? Are you testifying? Do you know that you are loved by Jesus? If so, then yes, it's a good thing. Jesus is coming. We hope, we pray, we long for it. But listen, those things aren't true for you. If you don't know that you have the love of Jesus in your life, if you have not been transformed by the grace of the gospel of Jesus Christ, this is very, very bad news for you. And I urge you to repent now. Turn away from your sin. Trust Jesus. Jesus died so that this is not, so this won't be a miserable experience for you. There'll just be a day of reckoning to come under his judgment. But no, this will be his glorious return when you'll be rescued from sin forever and get to be with him forever. That's the gospel. So repent and trust him today before it's too late. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, there's so much that you have made us to be and called us to be as your church. Help us to live up to this. By the Holy Spirit, help us to be faithful to these things. Help us to die to ourselves that we may be your servants who are ready to do whatever you tell us to do. Lord, help us not to forget that we are loved by Christ who died for us and to love others accordingly. Help us to overcome our fears, to be bold in sharing our faith, and help us to continue to hold fast to the truth and not believe Satan's lies. Lord, help us to be faithful priests as we minister to you and before you. And Lord, we long for your return. We long to see you. Lord, come quickly. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Please stand as we sing our closing hymn.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch.
You may be seated. Do we have any announcements? Okay.
I don't know if that's on here. Take
it.
It is. Okay, great.
Okay. All right. It's on. Good. Well, I just had a few announcements that I wanted to make at the end of the day here. In this time, it's so hard to, with COVID and everything, to actually do some ministry. So I want to tell you about the ministry that we're doing here at the church, and we're using the building, the church building, which is for a blood drive. And it's Wednesday, 2 to 7. Red Cross is doing it. We're just letting them use our building for that purpose. You have to make an appointment to come donate blood because they only have limited spots because of the COVID. They could have to have a separation. But do check if you do make an appointment, because they've had some issues just like the rest of us with ill folks, and they had to either scale back this week or they couldn't do it at all. I'm not sure which, but
this past week.
So that's one thing. I'm going to have to put my glasses back on so I can see all of them. So, you know, we this church for a long time has helped other churches start, and some of them are still going. Some of them have grown a lot bigger than we have, and some of them have started new churches, in fact. So what Daniel was saying today about just telling one person and you doubled the size of your church, we're trying to do that again. But so we are helping. He was a local guy, grew up here, and then he moved away to school, got married, came back. Now he's starting a church. His name's Cody Woodley. And this Saturday at 6 p.m., we're going to let him use our building. They're going to host a launch party, which is where he's telling people about him. Anybody that wants to join with him can do that. That's at 6 p.m. this Saturday, the 25th. And then he will be preaching on Sunday for us for our benefit and to showcase himself, I guess, and what God's doing with him. I hate to say that way, because we can do nothing without God, that is for sure. So I wanted to pray for a few people that are out. We got Kevin is out today and Doug is out. They're both helping other churches today. So Kevin's helping churches all over Tennessee and Doug is helping churches locally. So they're both preaching in other places today. I just want to pray for their safety and for them to bring God's word to where they're at. We've got a few people out that may be sick. You know, of course, anytime you got a sniffle, we're worried about COVID. So we just pray that it's not that and that it's just the sniffles. And we've got that. I want to thank Daniel for preaching again today. Always brings God's word lovely, and it's always our blessing to hear him. He's also living it out, him and his family. If you haven't already heard this, Daniel and his family are going to Mexico. Mm-hmm. And, process starts early November.
Right.
We're not always sure what time we leave it with those things, but, his ministry, nobody's asked me to do this, but I just felt that I should do this today. We use money in this world to make our ministries go. So I'm going to imagine that Daniel has a place to go if you would like to support his ministry. I'm not going to put him on the spot today, but we can put it on our website. So keep looking for that, a way that you can support his family. They spent a number of years, was it 3 years, mm-hmm. in Dominican. And now they are going to Mexico to do their next, how would you describe it? Your next
assignment?
Adventure?
Yeah.
Assignment? you feel God's got you led to do? So just want to let everybody know about those things and pray for those folks that are out and the folks that are just trying to stay healthy by staying home and staying away and quarantining. And isolating themselves. We just pray for you guys. If you would, just pray with me and we will be dismissed. Lord, we thank you so much for your many blessings. We thank you for the opportunities that you give us to share your word. We ask for the ability, the drive, you know, that it be our pleasure that we go out and we tell people about you, Lord. That we know what we have, and when you have something good, you want to tell everybody. So, Lord, I just pray that whether it's going out today and speaking to people or calling somebody on the phone today, if you're staying at home and trying to stay away from everybody, not to spread this COVID, Lord, we pray that that this COVID, it just brings the blessings of doing that, showing us that how we need each other and how we need to support each other. Lord, I thank you. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Amen.